Hi, today we are continuing with the study of the Lord's Prayer and discussing Luther's explanation according to Luther's Small Catechism. I'm Terry Karshnick and would like to thank Pastor Kufall for being with us today, leading us through today's study.
Afternoon, Terry.
Good afternoon.
And afternoon to your viewers now. We thank you for your time and just clicking on us to check and see what we have to say. And so today we're working through Luther's Small Catechism, as Terry had mentioned, and we're going through the Lord's Prayer. As we look at the different petitions that are there, we're going to dig a little bit deeper into what that means and what each one says, because the tendency that we have when we say the Lord's Prayer is we just ramble right through it. It's good for us to pause and as we think on each one of these petitions as to what they have to say for our lives and what it is that we are actually praying and making a little bit more of an impact on our thought process for our day as well as and what we are asking God. And so thank you for clicking on us once again, and let's dive in.
Okay.
But before we begin, let's begin with a word of prayer. So we pray. Gracious Lord God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for the many blessings you continue to give to us each and every day. One of the greatest gifts that you give to us is that gift of the Holy Spirit, that gift that strengthens us, that gift that brings us faith, and that gift that enables us to trust in you. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this gift of the Holy Spirit, and we pray that by his power, our hearts may be turned to you. So in this time when we're digging into your word, may you open our faith, that we may be drawn closer to you, that we may be strengthened and encouraged, and that we may learn something. So bless us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Well, last time we got together, we talked at the introduction, and that first petition, you know, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Now we get into the second and third petitions today.
Okay, sounds good.
Thy kingdom come. All right. Well, Terry, when we talk about a kingdom, what do you think of?
Palace, beautiful place. Just to me, the warm, beautiful place, I think. That's heaven.
Okay. Yeah, you know, we think of back the days of, you know, King Arthur and Knights of the Round Table. We think of a kingdom, a ruling type of thing. You know, and it almost is a fairy tale aspect of it. I think in the United States, for the most part, many children today have that fairy tale aspect when they bring on the mentality of a kingdom because, well, we have a president, so to speak.
Yeah.
And so we don't often think of what a kingdom actually is.
Mm-hmm.
But it's interesting because when we think of this statement, you know, thy kingdom come, one of the things we often hearken back to is, well, the words of John the Baptist. John the Baptist was that precursor to Jesus, of course. He was the one called, who was sent to prepare his way. And he gave a simple calling. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And then when Jesus began his ministry, once John was arrested, Jesus used those exact same words. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Well, what is this kingdom?
Yeah.
Well, let's start looking, of course, with what Luther has to say. Well, what does this mean? And he states, the kingdom of God certainly comes by itself without our prayer, but we pray in this petition that it may come to us also. Well, he then goes on to ask the question, well, how does God's kingdom come? Well, God's kingdom comes when our Heavenly Father gives us His Holy Spirit so that by His grace we believe His holy word and lead godly lives here in time and then there in eternity.
Yep.
All right. So, when we think of a kingdom, oftentimes, as we stated, we go and kind of go to that magical place or a powerful ruling.
Okay, yeah.
But as individual Christians, praying, let thy kingdom come, or when we hearken back to those words of John and Jesus about the kingdom of heaven being at hand, one of the things we have to recognize and bring it into our own question, well, who's ruling over me? Who is my king? Now,
makes you think.
It makes us think, of course. Now, oftentimes when we think about that aspect of things, of who is ruling over me, we like to say, well, me.
Well, you'd like to think that, but yeah, you still answer to somebody.
Well, we should answer to somebody.
Yeah.
But oftentimes we don't like answering to anybody except ourselves.
That's right.
You know, and then that goes right back into the first commandment issue, doesn't it? You shall have no other gods.
Yep.
Right? As Christians, we recognize that God, our Heavenly Father, is the ruler and the Lord of our life. And when we recognize in that aspect of things, we also recognize that then He is our King. He rules over us.
Right.
So when we pray, let thy kingdom come, we're basically praying that God's going to allow himself to rule over us.
It's a good way to put it.
So that we are under his rule, under his care, under his salvation.
As it should be.
Yeah. It's not a bad thing.
No.
But in a world of machoism, so to speak, we have trouble with that. Our sinful nature wants to rebel. It wants to fight against that.
That's true.
And so this isn't always an easy statement for us to pray, because we want to be the ones calling the shots in our lives.
Well, when you understand exactly what it's saying, that's the part, yeah. Otherwise, you just blow through it. You don't really think about it. But when you stop and think about it, this is very important.
That's right. And so when it states in that first part of the meaning, well, what does this mean? The kingdom of God certainly comes by itself without our prayer, but we pray in this petition that it may come to us also. Mm-hmm. Well, we recognize that God's going to do his work.
Okay.
God's God, and he has his plan. Mm-hmm. But as he commands us, he calls us to pray. Calls us to come before him with anything that's on our heart. One of the things we have to recognize is that, well, let's pray that God's kingdom comes, that he lets, you know, that he does rule over us. Mm-hmm. We want him to rule over us. We want to be under his control. And that's often a tough thing, as we mentioned, to actually pray.
Yeah. Yeah, it is.
You know? And so we recognize that God's going to do his work no matter what. But we pray that we recognize that he's going to be the one doing it.
Right. Right, exactly.
And that's the issue there. You know, we want to acknowledge that fact. You know, like we talked about, well, we'll see a little bit later when we get to give us this day thy daily bread.
There you go.
You know, but we want to recognize where these things come from. You know, and so we pray that in this petition that it does come upon us, you know. So, and when you say, how does God's kingdom come? Well, God's kingdom comes when our Heavenly Father gives us his Holy Spirit. Once again, one of the things that we recognize as Lutherans is that God gives us this amazing gift of faith. Mm-hmm. It's nothing that we create. It's not an aha moment that something in our brain just clicks and, oh, we get it now. We finally understand. But it's getting credit where credit is due. It's that I can't come up with this stuff on my own. Because of my sinful nature, I'm just going to go the other way. But the Holy Spirit's the one who works that faith within us, who creates that faith. And so when we pray in this petition, we're praying that God gives us his Holy Spirit to work that faith within us, to say, hey, I need to be under you, right, dear Heavenly Father, Father in heaven. And not only that, but when we pray, thy kingdom come, we're also praying that God's Holy Spirit's going to work in the lives of others. You know, ultimately, I'm praying that it's going to work within you, within Greg.
Right.
Within the members of our congregation, mm-hmm, both in the sanctuary or not, And for those who are struggling with their faith, those who are opposed to the faith, when we pray, Thy kingdom come, we pray that the Holy Spirit's going to come and work within the hearts and rule in the hearts of all people. You know, and through that prayer, I think one of the things that might happen is that we just think of all those people in our lives who are hurting in their faith, or people who are against God and His will.
Don't understand.
Yeah. And so it's a wonderful petition of encouragement, so to speak.
It's quite broad, is what you're talking about. Oh, I mean, it means a lot.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's pretty interesting.
Yeah, and I love the fact that Luther includes, so that by His grace we believe His holy word and lead godly lives here in time and there in eternity. He separates the two. There's a big difference that's going to be taking place. We're praying that God is going to strengthen and do the work of His word here on earth. But it's something that's going to go beyond that. There's an eternal measure to all of this. A timeless gift, the timeless aspect of God's blessings and His gifts.
And that's my hope.
Yeah. And so, because in heaven, where everybody, of course, wants to go when they die, it's not where we're going to be in control and doing this and that and everything we love to do. But in heaven, if God's going to be there, and if God's our God, we're going to be under His control, under His rule, under His reign.
That's what's supposed to be here, so like you say, should be the same.
Exactly. That's what He's preparing us for. Mm-hmm. You know, that life without sin. You know, and that's one of the things that boggles me about heaven, that there's going to be absolutely no sin there.
That is interesting, isn't it?
Because each and every aspect of our life is burdened down, weighed down by the effects of sin.
Yeah.
You know, we know death, we know sickness, we know people who are at odds with each other. We know that anger and all that other stuff. But God prepares us for a life that's to come. He says, that's not what I've made you for. That's not what I've redeemed you for. I've redeemed you for a life free from sin.
It's a pretty wonderful thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we definitely want God's kingdom to come and live among us here in this time and there in eternity.
Definitely.
It's a good thing.
That's right, yes.
And so, but I think one of the hard times that things that we ask for is when, you know, we just see so much of the other stuff. We see the bad stuff, you know, in this world.
Yeah.
And that weighs us down. I said, well, has God been listening to my prayers? Does God even care about me?
There's been times when I thought that.
Well, we all have. Mm-hmm. But the gift that God gives to us right here in praying this is that we do want Him to come.
Yeah.
You know, come, Jesus, quickly come. Because we long for the day when there is going to be no sin.
Yeah.
And so until that time, we pray, once again, God's kingdom come, especially for those who haven't heard His word, who have refused to hear the gospel message, who refused to want God's reign over them,
right,
God's kingdom over them. Because time is short and, well, hell is hot, as said one of our dear presidents of the Missouri Senate. So, Thy kingdom come. Now that leads us into our next petition, the third petition, which is Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Now this is often one of the hardest things we ever will pray in our entire life. That's saying, okay, God, I trust You completely to take care of my life. I'll step aside here and I'll set aside my desires for Yours.
It's pretty broad.
Pretty broad, and it's pretty rough.
Mm-hmm.
Because once again, our sinful nature says, my way or the highway.
Yeah.
You know, we think of how we deal with people and how in our closest of relationships where we're called to compromise, You know, there's that butting of heads because it's two opposing wills.
Yeah, right.
It just doesn't want to work. But here, as Christians, in the Lord's Prayer, we pray, Your will be done, not mine.
Not mine.
So let's hear what Luther has to say about that. What does this mean? The good and gracious will of God is done even without our prayer, but we pray in this petition that it may be done among us also. Well, how is God's will done? God's will is done when He breaks and hinders every evil plan and purpose of the devil, the world, and our sinful nature, which do not want us to hallow God's name or let His kingdom come. And when He strengthens and keeps us firm in His word and faith until we die. This is His good and gracious will. So, once again, it states it all pretty clear. Now, one of the blessings of the Luther's Small Catechism with explanations from Concordia Publishing House is that they have all these wonderful little extra questions and answers given from scriptural backgrounds. And one of the first questions that follows this that they have added is the question of what is the good and gracious will of God? You know, and that's always a tough thing for us to fathom. Well, what is God's will for my life? You know, why am I here? What is my purpose? That's a big thing. And if we were going to Scripture, it just seems so vague.
It really does, yes.
But one of the things that we recognize when we do spend time with God and His Word is that we do begin to see a pattern of what His will is. You know, we've talked about those Ten Commandments. We hear what sin is, and we see what it does in the lives of God's people. You know, it's not God's will that we fall into that type of a lifestyle, but one that is beneficial to our neighbor, one that serves our neighbor in the best way, not take advantage of our neighbor for ourselves.
Help your fellow neighbor, help or work with them.
Exactly. Yeah. In John chapter 6, Jesus says, "For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who looks on the Son and believes in Him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day." Right there, Jesus plainly states what the will of God is. That all people would look to Jesus, to look to the Son of God, and trust in Him, believe in Him, that they may have eternal life, that He could raise them up on the last day. Now, the promise of the resurrection, that's the will of God. Because that's why He came, Jesus was sent, that we could be forgiven, that we could be saved and have eternal and everlasting life. That's God's will right there.
Right there. Yeah.
Paul writes in 1 Timothy chapter 2, God desires all people to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. You know, there's no in-between area. That's what God wants. He wants people to be saved. Once again, this is why He sent Jesus into our flesh to bear our sin and to be our Savior. But the problem is, and this goes back once again to our previous petition and the ones before it as well, is when we don't want to be under God's rule. When we oppose God's will. You know, and right off the bat, you know, what does this mean? The good and gracious will of God is done even without our prayer. But we pray in this petition that'll be done among us also. Well, how is God's will done? God's will is done when He breaks and hinders every evil plan and purpose of the devil, the world, and our sinful nature. And I think it's a key aspect on that, that He includes, you know, once again, all those three, but it comes back to our sinful nature, our sinful selves. You know, God, Your will be done.
Yeah.
You know, we like to ask God for anything.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
You know, and God wants us to ask Him for anything and everything. with all confidence and boldness. He wants us to bring all of our petitions, all of our concerns, all of our wants, all of our needs to Him. He wants to be in communication with us at all times. Pray without ceasing, right?
Right, yeah.
Hi, Greg.
Sorry.
That's okay. We just didn't want to forget about you over there.
Yeah.
But one of the hardest things for us to accept, and one of the biggest struggles that we have, is when we feel our prayers aren't answered.
Yeah.
When something we pray for so vehemently, so heartfelt, which we think is the best thing for our lives, and we don't get it. And we're crushed, and we're mad, and we're angry at God.
Been there, done that.
All of us have.
Yeah.
But here's the hard part about that for us, is that when we don't get Him, we of course think we know best, right?
Yeah.
But once again, if God, we desire to be under God's rule, under His kingdom, and we pray, God, You know what's best for me better than I know what's best for me, mm-hmm. then Your will be done. But we argue about that. And so sometimes our old sinful nature says, my way or the highway, God.
Yeah.
And that's not right. We have to trust that God definitely knows what's best for us in our life.
It comes back to that word faith again.
Exactly. And if we don't get what we ask for, if things don't go as we want, are we supposed to be mad at God then?
Well, I'm certain that there's been many times that I've been upset with God.
Well, sure.
But I always come back. Always come back.
But we have to trust and we have to pause and say, God, okay, Your will be done.
Right.
You know what's best for me. Even more so than I know what's best for me. You know, and when we look in our world and when we see times in which death and destruction, I was just reading that tornadoes ravaged through, you know, the southern U.S. again this afternoon. When we look and see all that stuff that happens, terrorist attacks, people doing stupid things to one another, car accidents, you name it.
Yeah.
Is that God's will? How can that be good? How could a good God want something like that to happen?
I've questioned that too many times.
And that's tough. Now, we don't know the reason why some of those things happen, but we do know that when God calls us not to take the lives of others, you know, that is a sin. It's yeah. not how what He has intended.
Right.
But once again, what is that will of God? That all may be saved and have eternal life. It may have been that time, God's call, that time for them to come home in horrible means.
Yeah.
But one of the blessings that we have is that we have this opportunity to share this good news with one another, to share the love of Jesus, to share who our Savior is and how important He is with one another when we have that opportunity. Because we just never know when our time may be.
Right.
We just don't know. But what we do know is that God has promised that for those who trust in Him, those who look to the Son, will have eternal life. So we set ourselves aside and say, okay, God, Your will be done.
Yeah, yes.
Now, one of the things, you know, like I said, we talked about like those terrorist attacks and all that. That's not definitely God's will, or why did He allow that to happen? And we don't know. But what we do know is that God gives us and uses those times to wake those of us who remain up and say, hey, I need to make sure that I'm okay with my God. Yeah. Because it's a result of a broken and a sinful world where the devil looks to destroy. Does that mean that God willingly stepped aside and let the devil do his thing? Not necessarily.
It sure makes you think about it, though, doesn't it?
It makes you think. And the temptation for us is then to say, well, the devil has more power than God, or that God allowed that to happen.
Well, there's no doubt that I've felt that way in the past, but again, it, with the faith, you come back and you pray and get it straight.
Exactly. You know? And that's what God promises to do. Right. Once again, thy kingdom come, God, let me be under you. Mm-hmm. And let your will be done. I'll trust you with my life.
Right.
Each and every aspect of it. And that's the hardest thing.
It is. You know, what you said, this is easy.
No, it's not. But despite all of that, once again, going back then, once again, and let thy kingdom come, it's also letting that Holy Spirit enter our lives. Or God working that Holy Spirit in our lives to do some amazing things to enable us to trust him. Our sinful nature can't, but right. That Holy Spirit within us can.
I believe there's truth to that. I absolutely believe in that. So that's the good part about this.
And you believe by the work of the Holy Spirit.
Absolutely.
That's the work of God.
Yeah.
Because even in the darkest situations, most horrible things, God puts us within a community to support and encourage and care for one another.
Right. Yeah. And we do.
Exactly. Because it's that faith response. Mm-hmm. That's all we can do.
Yeah, I agree.
So I thank you for tuning in, for watching, checking us out. I know it's not always the most exciting thing, especially looking at these two mugs. But we thank you for your time. We're going to continue on in next week with our next installment as we look to the fourth and fifth petitions of the Lord's Prayer. But if you ever have questions, you know, email us. You can contact us at the link provided above. Hopefully we're working that out on our website stuff. But if not, it's at trinityrev2@frontiernet.net. One of the questions that we have had was, it was asked, as Lutherans, should we use the sign of the cross while praying? Well, there's absolutely nothing wrong with using the sign of the cross. One of the blessings that we have is that during our, when we were baptized, the minister more than likely marked you with the cross of Christ, both upon your forehead and upon your heart, to mark you as one redeemed by Christ the crucified. That mark of the cross is one of those gifts that reminds us that I've been baptized, that the cross of Christ covers me.
I've noticed that some churches, that's all they do. I mean, they show the cross. Well, I believe in our church, I don't believe we do that. Some may do, maybe do, but seldom. And yeah. I've often thought, is that right or wrong? So I think this is a great question. Mm-hmm.
Well, oftentimes that's been one of the traditions predominantly in the Catholic Church, mm-hmm. for one reason or the other. And because we can't associate with Catholics, or we shouldn't look too Catholic, we shouldn't do that. I know that it was the previous generation's thought, so you shouldn't do
that. I think that's
that.
Probably how it was looked at, yeah.
But Luther always strongly encouraged his readers, his children, to always mark themselves with that cross of Christ before they, when they woke up in the morning and when they went to bed at night.
Okay.
And it's usually an addition into the connection of the name of the triune God, that name in which you were baptized, because that is he who covers you. And it's he who goes before you, he who follows after you. Mm-hmm. You know, so it's not a bad thing. It's one of those reminders for ourselves of what God has done for us in Christ Jesus. There's no necessarily special way to do it. I think one of the times, you know, throughout the church service, when we do that, when we make mention specifically of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, it's not never a bad thing to mark yourself with the cross of Christ. Okay. You know, personally, I'll do that throughout the service quite frequently. But the one time that I do not is when the pastor makes that sign of the cross, at the, for example, like during the forgiveness of sins, that absolution part, you know, over the congregation. Because one of the things that I view at that point of time as the pastor is the one who has been called and ordained to be that authoritative voice of God before his congregation He is the one who's marking that cross. It's kind of like a blessing that's been given.
Okay.
And so, but that's just my mentality and reason.
But it makes sense. It makes good sense. But, yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, that's good. That's a good question. I'm glad we addressed this.
Yeah. So thank you for those questions. But thank you for once again clicking, putting up with us, and watching us to the very end.
Yes, yes, yes.
And as we close, let us close with our Lord's Prayer. Once again, as not just rambling through these petitions, but thinking, meditating, remembering what they mean for our lives and what it is that we are actually asking God to do. Therefore, we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And dear viewers, may the Lord bless you and your families. May he continue to watch over you. May he keep you safe from all the temptations that the devil looks to throw at you. Thanks for watching, and God bless.